Good morning, Lehmanite Town. Welcome to God's House in the Back Mountains of Pennsylvania. I'm Pastor Lauren, very glad to see everybody who came out on this Thanksgiving weekend, the first Sunday of Advent, and those who are tuning in and joining us through digital means. Does anybody have any announcements? Jane.
I have to have the poinsettias. I don't need the money. I just need the order. How many poinsettias you want? I have to hand it in by Tuesday or we won't get it.
Poinsettia orders get to Jane today. Money can come later, but the order has to be in today. And if you're on Zoom and you would like to order anything, please feel free to send us an email or respond in the chat there. Others? Diane?
Next Sunday is the fire department breakfast. Lehman Fire Department.
Breakfast at the I-Town Fire Department next Sunday after worship, not before. Amy? Our daily bread is here. If anybody would like some, there's copies in the back. Kendra.
And there's five angel tree names left if anyone's interested, and the gifts need to be returned next Sunday. If you're not coming to church, I'll be here from 2 to 3:30 downstairs to take gifts. So.
Okay, we still have five angels left on our angel tree. That's five children that need some gifts. Please search your heart about taking one. They would need to be returned next Sunday. And if you can't do it during worship, Kendra will be here from 2 to 3:30 in the afternoon to collect them as well. Others? There are a few others that I'd like to mention. This afternoon at 3 o'clock is our annual charge conference. It's in person here at the church, and anybody who is a member of the church can come to this and vote. Also, tomorrow night, the Y team will be meeting at Grottos in Harvey's Lake at 6:30. We're doing this partly to celebrate and admire the tree that's up. Our church, and I think I saw in the paper that ours was the only church listed and all the other businesses that sponsor a tree out there. Any funds collected go towards the pastor's food pantry in Knoxon. Also in mission work, we're hosting our dinner for Vision, the homeless men, at Camp Orchard Hill, Saturday, December 18th. There's a sign-up sheet in the back requesting donations, and if you can help serve. Any questions, please see Audrey Ide here today. Anything that I may have forgotten or overlooked? Next Sunday is the Children's Christmas Program during worship, so please be sure to come out and as we see the and celebrate the children with us. Amy.
We were just curious if we had a Joash number.
Oh, we've got a Joash number. Go ahead.
Do we have
a Joash number? No, I think it was something sent to us this week.
Okay, I can look over here.
Okay, and then we can put that up as a joy during joys and concerns. Anything else? Then let's prepare our hearts for worship this morning.
Thank you.
invite you to rise in body or spirit and join me in the call to worship. It is not true that creation and the human family are doomed to destruction and loss.
This is true, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life.
It is not true that we must accept inhumanity and discrimination, hunger and poverty, death and destruction.
This is true. I have come that they have my life and abundance.
It is not true that violence and hatred should have the last word, and that war and destruction rule forever.
This is true. Unto a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder. His name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, the Everlasting, the Prince of Peace.
It is not true that we are simply victims of the powers of evil who seek to rule the world.
This is true. To me is given authority in heaven and on earth, and lo, I am with you, even until the end of the world.
It is not true that we have to wait for those who are specially gifted, who are the prophets of the church, before we can be peacemakers.
This is true. I will pour out my spirit on all flesh, and your sons and daughters shall prophesy. Your young men shall dream of dreams.
It is not true that our hopes for liberation of humankind, of justice, of human dignity, of peace, are not meant for this earth and for this history.
This is true. The hour comes, and it is now, that the true worshipers shall worship God in spirit and in truth.
So, let us enter Advent in hope, even hope against hope.
Let us see visions of love, peace, and justice. Let us affirm with humility, with joy, with faith, with courage, Jesus Christ, the light of the world.
Let us pray together. Gentle God, you know that for us, this is a season of hopes and fears. We are caught up in our excitement and plans. We worry whether everything will get done and whether our relationships will blossom, bend, or break in the stress of the season. Slow us down, God, and help us to place our hope in you. Be our calm center, that we may be channels of peace to the people around. Through the grace of Jesus Christ. Amen. And together let us raise our voices in O Come, Emmanuel, verses 1, 4, and 5.
Good morning. Today we're going to light the candle of hope and prepare the way for the Lord. Hope. As we celebrate this first Sunday in Advent, the scriptures tell us nothing is impossible with God. Elizabeth carried the child John, who would prepare the way for Jesus. Mary carried the child Jesus, who prepares a place in his Father's kingdom for all those who believe. And from Titus we hear, prepare yourselves with faith and knowledge, resting on the hope of eternal life, which God, who does not lie, promised before time began. Let us bow our head in prayer. Jesus, Savior of hope, thank you for our yesterdays, todays, and tomorrows. Prepare our hearts to turn from our chaos to your loving guidance. Amen.
Let us sing together, Light the Advent Candle, verse 1. Okay. How about you, Mel? What'd you have?
I had mashed potatoes and corn.
You had mashed potatoes too. How many like mashed potatoes? With gravy? Oh, one says no, and everybody else goes yes.
Two.
Oh, two went no. Okay. Well, you know what? When people see Thanksgiving, you know what they think next? Christmas shopping. Christmas shopping. And it's official. We have now entered in to the Christmas countdown. Every day you're going to hear on the radio or see on the computer or in the newspaper a countdown that tells us we have so many shopping days left until Christmas. 24, 23, 22. If you're lucky, at home you might have an advent calendar that each day you open a little door on, and some of them have pieces of chocolate in behind. Yeah, and that helps you count down then till Christmas. But there's signs that Christmas is coming, and these signs are all around us. What are some signs you see about Christmas?
Wreaths.
What?
Wreaths and Christmas trees.
Christmas trees? Patrick?
Jesus' birthday.
Jesus' birthday, but how do we know it's coming up?
Because
What do we see? Nativities, Michael.
I was gonna say nativities.
All right, great. These are wonderful signs, and there are plenty of signs for us today that Christmas is coming. Lights on all over the place at night, Christmas music all over. But 2,000 years ago, can you imagine that? 2,000 years ago, when Jesus was born, there were no big signs that announced, hey, Jesus is here, except for, what's that above the manger over there?
A star.
A star, that's right. There were some, but there were no ads on TV. There were no ads in the newspaper or on the radio saying, coming soon, a Savior will be born. No, people were surprised when Jesus was born. They certainly didn't expect him to be born in a stable, laid in a feeding trough, you know, a bed that animals would eat out of. They never expected that. But as word spread around that the Son of God had been born, that God had kept his promise, some people began to remember that prophets, these were people who spoke and told what God told them to say years and years before Jesus was born. They remembered that the prophets said Jesus was coming. And so they remembered that God was keeping his promise. Christmas is not only a wonderful time to celebrate the birth of Jesus, it's a time to remember that Jesus made us a promise, that Jesus would come again. Someday Jesus is going to come back. We don't know when that's going to be, but we do know that Jesus will. And that candle of hope that we lit today helps remind us of that. Just as the people of Israel had hope in the promise of God, we find hope in Jesus' promise that he will come again. Let's pray. Loving God, thank you for keeping your promise to send a Savior. We thank you too, Lord, for the promise that Jesus will return again to take us to our home in heaven. And we thank you, Lord, for all the grown-ups in these children's lives who seek to teach them your stories, your good news. We pray this in Christ's name, and all God's children said,
amen.
Thanks for coming up this morning. Since we have last gathered together, where have you seen God, or do you have joys or concerns that you'd like to mention that we can all pray for? And again, if you're on Zoom, feel free to unmute yourself and call out, or just send it to us in the chat. Amy's got her hand up.
Well, I think I've heard that somebody's birthday is today or tomorrow. That is Michael.
Michael has a birthday tomorrow. Happy birthday. Okay, the Joash chest offering as of last Sunday was $4,917, and we had just enough to pay for our shoe boxes that got shipped out. All right, others? Audrey.
My neighbor cleaned the driveway this morning before I got to it, so that was a nice moment.
Audrey's neighbor cleaned her driveway for her. While we're talking about joys and birthdays, I'm going to give a shout out to my mom, whose birthday is today. Happy birthday, Mom. She's on Zoom. Others. Robin.
Prayers for my neighbor, Gary. prayers for those who are suffering emotionally and who have pain.
Okay, prayers for her neighbor Bill, who had emergency surgery and other health issues. He's had a very rough year. Others? Darwin?
This morning I was just looking at all the children. It's just a joy to see the number that has grown to. Praise the Lord.
The number of children here, it is a joy. Audrey.
Our grotto Christmas tree looks so creatively and beautifully decorated. That was very nice of those that did that.
The grotto Christmas tree looks nice from the pictures, yes. But we gotta go see it in person and vote for it too. Paisley.
Yeah.
Linda? Okay. Callie. Elves on the sitting on the shelf who come home for the holidays. Colleen.
Can we pray for our friend Lori Russell? She's going through some medical issues right now. She's getting chemo for leukemia.
Your friend Lori? Okay. Please keep the folks out in Wisconsin in your prayers. Last Sunday at a Christmas parade, somebody deliberately drove their SUV into it. There were five or six who were killed, and they ranged from young children to dancing grannies from Milwaukee. And there were many others who were injured and in the hospital. So please keep Wisconsin lifted up. Also, continued prayers for Bob and Linda.
Those traveling, got a big weekend.
Those who are traveling, it's a big weekend for travelers, and keep hunters in your prayers that they would be safe while they're out there and have a come away from the woods with a deeper appreciation of God's creation and provision. Others. Let's unite our hearts in prayer. Holy and gracious God, thank you for the beauty of this day, for in the snow that covers the ground and the trees, there is a sight to behold. And Lord, too, we give you thanks for shelter, for heat and warmth and food and family and friends. We also, though, remember those who don't have all of what we have. And we pray, Lord, that you would provide for them, making a way where there seems to be no way. That for those who are lonely, those who are feeling lost, that they would instead feel your presence with them, so they might know that they are not alone. Lord God, we're coming together this day from a big holiday weekend where there have been gatherings of family and friends. And in the midst of those, we remember the empty chairs. Those who were once had a seat at our table, but for some reason or other, no longer sit there. We remember too, Lord, the bonds of love that bind us together and bind us to you. Lord, on this day, as we have mentioned these different situations to you, a lot have brought chuckles to us, smiles to us, but there are others that fill our hearts with concern. To you, Lord, we trust each situation, knowing you are already there. Hear us now, O Lord, as we speak to you heart to heart in silence. there is no darkness at all, Lord, be in our hearts, Lord Jesus. Where there is sickness, grant healing. Where there is grief, grant your peace and comfort. And Lord, pour out your wisdom. You are the wise counselor. Be the wise counselor, Lord, for the leaders of our communities and our nations. We turn to you, O God, for guidance, for peace, for grace. This we give thanks and praise to you for, even as we pray the prayer that Christ taught us, saying, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and glory forever. Amen.
I invite you to give your attention to Kendra as she shares with us today the scripture lessons.
Good morning.
Morning.
I'll be reading from the King James Version of the Bible. The Old Testament reading is Jeremiah 33:14-16. Behold, the days come, saith the Lord, that I will perform that good thing which I have promised unto the house of Israel and to the house of Judah. In those days and at that time will I cause the branch of righteousness to grow up unto David, and he shall execute judgment and righteousness in the land. In those days shall Judah be saved, and Jerusalem shall dwell safely. And this is the name wherewith she shall be called, the Lord our righteousness. And the gospel reading is Luke chapter 21, verses 25 to 36. And there shall be signs in the sun, and in the moon, and in the stars, and upon the earth, distress of nations with perplexity, the sea and the waves roaring, men's hearts failing them for fear, and for looking after those things which are coming on the earth, for the powers of heaven shall be shaken. And then shall they see the Son of Man coming in a cloud with power and great glory. And when these things begin to come to pass, then look up and lift up your heads, for your redemption draweth nigh. And he spake to them a parable. Behold the fig tree and all the trees. When they now shoot forth, ye see and know of your own selves that summer is now nigh at hand. So likewise ye, when ye see these things come to pass, know ye that the kingdom of God is nigh at hand. Verily I say unto you, this generation shall not pass away till all be fulfilled. Heaven and earth shall pass away, but my word shall not pass away. And take heed to yourselves, lest at any time your hearts be overcharged with surfeiting and drunkenness and cares of this life, and so that day come upon you unawares. For as a snare shall it come on all them that dwell on the face of the whole earth. Watch thee therefore, and pray always, that you may be accounted worthy to escape all these things that shall come to pass, and to stand before the Son of Man. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Please rise in body or spirit for the glory of Patrick. Lord our God, day, fill us and surround us with your Holy Spirit, opening our minds that we might have a better understanding and appreciation for your teachings, filling our hearts with the lessons learned and the love that comes for you. And then, Lord, inspire us and move us so that everything we say and do mirrors the love you have for us and for others, that through what we say and do, you might be honored and glorified. In Christ we pray. Amen. Amen. Happy New Year!
Happy New Year!
Okay, I've got a few Happy New Year's back and a bunch of quizzical looks. Does anybody have an idea why we might say Happy New Year on the first Sunday of Advent? It's the first Sunday in the church year, the church calendar, the Christian year. And Advent means simply the arrival of a notable person or a notable event. Who's the notable person that we're celebrating?
Jesus.
What was it?
Jesus.
Jesus, that's right. You are awake. Good. Did you know that Advent also means and celebrates the coming or return of Christ? And that's why we light candles. That's why we decorate and buy or make gifts, to celebrate the advent of Christ. A new year brings with it farewells and expectations. We say farewell to the past and try to cast off bad memories. Some things we expect to continue as they have been, that our families, if they're close to start with, will remain close, that we will have the basic necessities, food, shelter, heat, indoor plumbing, that we will have access to medical care when we need it. We expect that in the new year, there will be better things in store for our loved ones and ourselves. Better health, better job security, better days. In short, the new year brings us hope. Hope. It's one of those small four-letter words that packs a wallop when it's said or even thought of. Hope, according to Maynard Grigard in the movie Pottersville, isn't always the most realistic thing, but it tends to make the world a better place. Hope, it's one of those thoughts, those feelings that inspire people to write poetry and prophets to prophesy. It inspired Emily Dickinson to write, "Hope is the thing with feathers that perches in the soul and sings the tune without the words and never stops at all. And sweetest in the gale is heard, and sore must be the storm that could have bashed the little bird that kept so many warm. I've heard it in the chillest land and on the strangest sea, yet never in extremity it asked a crumb of me." Jeremiah, known as the weeping prophet, wrote words of hope to an anxious and worried Israelite people. These were the people in exile. They had been conquered by the Babylonians and carried off to parts unknown. Jeremiah spent some of his exile and the end of his life in Egypt, that land that represented so much sorrow for the Israelites. When Jeremiah wrote many of his prophecies, the Israelite people thought that God had forgotten them, that God had abandoned them. They were lamenting, writing, composing Psalms like 137, "By the rivers of Babylon, there we sat down, and there we wept." In short, they were afraid. It was during this time that Jeremiah, one of the many prophets who could have been named by the Omaha tribe, Wetumpka, that is one who gives hope. In a letter to the exiles who were living in Babylon, far from the holy city of Jerusalem and far from the temple of God, Jeremiah gave hope by reminding them that God had not forgotten. God had not abandoned them. In a verse that's familiar to many, he writes these words from God: "For surely I know the plans I have for you, plans for your welfare and not for harm, to give you a future with hope." He continues in today's reading by reminding them that God will fulfill the promise made to the house of Israel and the house of Judah. God will cause a righteous branch to spring up for David. For us as Christians, our Wetumpka is Jesus Christ, the righteous branch of the family tree of David, a root of Jesse, the father of David. Jesus was sent by God to be our hope, our salvation. He came into a world in which the Israelite people were once again consumed by the fear that God had forgotten them. They were ruled and taxed mercilessly by the Romans. Their religious leaders were more concerned about lining their own pockets than they were about caring for the widows, the orphans, the poor. Instead of preaching revolt and kick the Romans out, though, Jesus came preaching forgiveness, love, and tear down the temple. Have you ever heard that lesson? Do you maybe remember it? The disciples were in Jerusalem marveling at the size of the stones and the buildings in this city. It would be akin to someone from a very rural area going to a large city like Philly, Pittsburgh, New York for the first time. And so as these disciples marveled and pointed it out to Jesus, Jesus said to them, "Not one stone will be left here upon another. All will be thrown down." From Mark 13. Jesus was going to tear down the temple, that ultimate symbol to the Israelites of worship, beauty, accomplishment, Solomon, David. In other words, the symbol of the glory days of Israel. We know that Jesus, when he said that, was talking about himself, that he was the temple of God, that in 3 days would be killed, lying in the tomb, and after those 3 days would be resurrected and live again. But at that time, as Jesus spoke, one of the things he was trying to do was to offer hope for the present and the future. He wanted the people to think less about the past and more about what comes next. And what does come next, according to Jesus? Well, Luke 21, 25, and 26 tells us there will be signs in the sun, the moon, and the stars, and on the earth distress among nations, confused by the roaring of the sea and the waves. People will faint from fear and foreboding of what is coming upon the world, for the powers of the heavens will be shaken. These predictions are similar to ones that can be found in Mark and elsewhere in the Holy Scriptures. Wars, rumors of wars, famines, earthquake, disease, the end of the world as we know it. It sounds pretty dismal and drear, doesn't it? But Jesus, our Wetumpka, gives us the way so that we might be saved. He tells us in verse 36 of Luke's reading today, be alert at all times, praying that you may have the strength to escape these things that will take place and to stand before the Son of Man. For Jesus will return again. It's a promise that we remember whenever we proclaim the mystery of faith as we celebrate Holy Communion. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We don't know when that will be, but we have hope that when he does, life will be better. For almost 2 years now, we have been living in unprecedented times, a worldwide pandemic that doesn't seem to be abating, and with new variations, Omicron being the latest, being found all the time. Supply chain issues provoked by the pandemic, leading to a shortage of merchandise. Live Christmas trees this year have been affected. Lowe's on Black Friday was already selling their floor models of artificial Christmas trees and outdoor Christmas decorations. I don't think I've ever seen that. I've seen them selling it a couple days before Christmas and after Christmas, but never this early on. But it's more than holiday decorations that are in short supply. Have you noticed how empty the grocery store shelves can be? How all retailers are displaying their merchandise to make the shelves and the stores appear more abundantly stocked than they really are. As supplies dwindle, costs increase. Our worries increase with the encroaching darkness of shorter days, and our hopes dwindle with the daylight. Yet, it was in the midst of darkness and despair, in the midst of chaos and disorder, that Christ, our Wetumpitha, was born in Bethlehem. Now, instead of dwelling on the chaos and the mayhem, let's think about what a future with Christ looks like, what it will be like. Paul writes in 2 Corinthians 5:17, so if anyone is in Christ, there's a new creation. Everything old has passed away. See, everything has become new. And in Revelations 21, we read something much very similar. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, see, the home of God is among mortals. He will dwell with them. They will be his peoples, and God himself will be with them. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. Death will be no more. Mourning and crying and pain will be no more, for the first things have passed away. What a hope. What a time to look forward to. As we prepare for Christmas this season, let us remember that it is the birthday of Jesus Christ, the Son of God, our Wetumpitha, that we celebrate. Let us remember, too, that Christ has already come and Christ will come again. Let us remember that we should be ready to welcome the day of his appearing, whenever that might be. To look forward to the time of the new creation when we will be praising and worshiping the one who created us, the one who brings us hope, the one who loves us this much. Let us pray. Maranatha, come, Lord Jesus. We look forward to the time when you will return and claim your followers. We thank you for the present that you have given us and the future that you have promised us. Help us, Lord, in this time of busyness to not overlook the gift of hope you bring to us this time of year and always. We thank you and praise you, Jesus, Son of God, righteous branch of David and Jesse. Amen. I invite you to rise in body or spirit and join in singing, Come, Thou Long Expected Jesus. And lights. If you see a nativity somewhere, take a picture of it. Email it to Amy and we'll get it up on our Facebook page. Let's flood it, flood the internet with remembrances of our hope and remember that Christ will come again. Go in the grace of God, the love of Christ, and the power of the Holy Spirit, now and forevermore. Amen.